Welcome to this IA on AI presentation. We are around, I think, 12 or so, 10 to 12 colleagues here in the Decima Lounge. And we also have quite a number of colleagues online, not only here in Tokyo, but also Gerard from the Consulate General, maybe also some other colleagues from the Consulate General. So that's very nice. We are very happy that you came in these big numbers, I think. And rightfully so, I think, because artificial intelligence, AI, is a very important technology in our daily lives. And you may or may not know it, but you are already using AI on a very regular basis, maybe even depending on it each day. And it will become an even more important technology in the future, in the near future. Now, Nicole has joined our IA team in March this year, and she has been working with us on various topics within the IA department. But one of the important topics was AI, and she did a research on that, and especially focusing on artificial intelligence in Japan, of course. Artificial intelligence is a key element, as you may know, to realize the Japanese ambitions in the domain of society 5.0. But also in the Netherlands, it is regarded as a very fundamental technology. We have even what is called in the Netherlands an AI coalition. That is a group of companies, research institutes, government officials that come together regularly to discuss the applications of artificial intelligence in the economy, in the society, and so forth. In February, we will have the visit of our State Secretary of Economic Affairs. It will be an online visit, of course, and the topic will be digital economy. But of course, within that framework, also artificial intelligence will be an important topic to be discussed, and especially the application of artificial intelligence in smart agriculture, smart industry, smart services. Now, Nicole has finished her report, her research report on artificial intelligence just recently, and we thought it would be a nice idea to share, let's say, the information that she has gathered with all of us, with you. Her report has been very well received in The Hague. Actually, it will be published next week.
I think next week.
Next week. A number of few articles that have been derived from this report have already been published online. If you are interested in those, please let us know. And we are most happy, of course, to share the links to those articles and also to the report. We can send the PDF and so on.
Of course, yes.
Nicole's presentation will be around 30, 35, maybe something like that, minutes. After that, we will have, Q&A, of course. But please do not run away directly after the Q&A or press the leave button for you who are online. Because we also want to use this opportunity that we are together say farewell to Nicole, because Nicole will be leaving us within 2 or 3 weeks. It is the end of her traineeship. She will go back to The Hague, and we thought that this would be a good opportunity to also say farewell. So that's for later, of course. Now it is Nicole on AI.
Yes, thank you so much for that introduction, Eric. Thank you. So today I will be telling you about AI, and mostly, of course, about the findings of my report. I started that report in April, and what started as a market and actor analysis over time became a bit broader because of COVID, of course, but in a way, I think also more interesting. So today I'm really happy that you all could join online and offline, I see. Well, AI is booming, so I think it's also good to have some basis. And well, of course, with the upcoming state secretary visits, all about smart industries and smart services and smart agriculture, I think it is good to have some basis. So with that, I will be running you through this content today. So the AI market, AI policy, the actors and sectors, COVID-19, and of course the challenges and opportunities. Now, as Eric already said, the questions are better to do at the end, but I think I will answer already one of your most important questions. What is AI? So AI is a very broad concept, but I use the one from the European Union, and that is machines that are able to learn, reason, and act for themselves. Now, to just give you a few examples, to get a little bit of feeling with it, I chose 6 examples that we already use in our daily lives and are also important during my presentation. So the first one is machine learning. And machine learning is basically the, well, which allows a machine to learn. You build an algorithm, and this algorithm you train over time with a bulk load of data, and the more data you give it and the better quality of the data, the machine will be able to make precise decisions or predictions for you. And I think we're already using this one quite a lot, because one famous one is Google Maps. So Google Maps takes live traffic data, but also past data, and combines this together, and then can make a pretty accurate prediction for you how long it takes to go from your house to the embassy. So that's machine learning. And if we move on to deep learning, I think it is a bit more sophisticated version of machine learning. This is basically the technique that stacks multiple algorithms on top of each other and makes it possible to make a more personalized recommendation for you, like like Netflix is doing. And then if you move on to speech recognition, this one is basically allowing a machine to get your speech, your human speech, translate that to text, and then also to a simple command. And I think the most famous example is here, Apple Siri. Then moving on to natural language processing, again, a bit more sophisticated, which basically means that if you have a machine, it is able to understand the meaning of your words. And WhatsApp, the WhatsApp autocomplete function actually understands what you are typing, how you're typing, and can also personalize it for you. Then, of course, we have also image processing. This technique allows you to extract information from an image. And I think I've used this one the most here, because Google Translate allowed us in the beginning of this year to make a picture of a text. It recognized that there's text on the image and then translates the Japanese ingredients automatically to Dutch. Very convenient, especially for me. And then finally, we have computer vision. So computer vision takes it the next step. And this means that the computer knows what is on the image, not just extracting information, but actually understanding the meaning of the image. And this one is used by Facebook. So if you would ever try to post any indecent pictures online on Facebook, the Facebook algorithms actually recognize if you will post any nudity on it, and then it will automatically censor it. So these are the 6 techniques I saw the most. And I think, again, during the presentation, you will see them back. So for now, these 6 are the most interesting. These are, of course, not all the AI that exists, but we'll keep it at that. So if I move on to the AI market, I will start with the global market, or at least how it should look in 2025. And to start with, AI is booming. That's the prediction, but I think that is also pretty clear. The first one is the compound annual growth rate. It's expected to become between 33% to 55%. And then, of course, we also have the prediction that the AI market will be worth between 156 to 360 billion euros. But I must say here that these numbers are actually from before COVID-19. So it might have changed a bit, but these are the latest numbers. And also, I don't think it has changed enough to say that AI is not booming anymore. What I also saw is that machine learning, as we just described, machine learning is expected to be number one on the AI market. And right now it's still natural language processing, but also because of deep learning, again, a part of machine learning, will increase from millions to billions. So that's quite interesting. And then last but definitely not least for Japan, the Asia Pacific region is expected to become number one in the market. Right now it's still North America, because well, the United States, but this will change in 2025. Now, if we zoom in on Japan, don't worry, you don't have to read this all, but this is just an overview, well, actually, of the amount of patent applications on AI, and this research is from METI, the Ministry of Economics, and they actually have three conclusions. Well, first, that this is the third AI boom in Japan. The second one is that indeed machine learning, just like on the global level, is increasingly becoming more important. And what they also saw is that deep learning is a big part of this. And even if you don't see it on the right, I'm not sure if you can read it, but that is mostly because machine learning is a supportive technology. So it is not described there. And of course, as this graph shows, a rapid rise of domestic patent applications, what you can see over time. Now, if we zoom in on the patent applications, so this is the top 10 companies in Japan with AI patents. Toshiba, clearly the biggest here. But Toshiba is not just important in Japan. In the world, it's number three. And what Japan is also number three in is AI R&D investment, so after China and the United States. What I also found is that there are 200 to 300 AI-related companies in Japan. But I must say here that these numbers increase really rapidly. So just to give you some feeling with this, the latest number I have of the Netherlands are between 300 and 350. But these numbers are from last year. And again, to give some feeling with it, not even 3 years ago, the Netherlands and Japan both had only 40 AI-related companies. So it is, well, it is definitely booming. And then the last one, Japan is number one in the supply of industrial robots. And it is expected that over time, the global market will have or will see a big rise in demand for AI supported industrial robots. And I think I've bombed you with a lot of numbers. So just to show you one of these robots, this is Ugo, a very Japanese robot. And what this robot also has encountered, like many other Japanese robots, is during COVID-19, it has changed. So this industrial maintenance robot, well, had nice industrial arms, but it is now given hands so he can clean doorknobs and also a fission that it can recognize if you have a fever. And then it became a security robot. So just to show you one example. Then moving on to AI policy in Japan. I just want to show you the basic assumption here. So Japan works on human-centric AI. And this is, again, a very broad concept. But it basically means that AI should be made for humans, to enhance humans and to aid humans and not to replace humans. And in that way, they have well, similar values to the European Union, like, well, values and guidelines are a big part of this principle. And what I noticed that values like transparency and privacy and non-discrimination, those values are very important in the human-centric approach. So important even that I noticed that they saw, or they signed guidelines with the European Union about human-centric AI last year in April. And also with the OECD in May last year. And of course, at the G20 in June last year. So just so we know that we do have a similar value set and a similar basic assumption that AI should help society. And with that, I move on to the AI strategy. And please do not read this all again, because this is from the Japanese government and it's a lot of information, but I will walk you through it. So what this is, well, the AI strategy of Japan, it is hugely based on Society 5.0. And for those that do not know what Society 5.0 is, I would say it is the vision of the Japanese government, how the future of Japan or the future society will be designed. And it's heavily supported by digital solutions and technology. And of course, AI is playing a big part in this. And so Japan, designed one of the first AI strategies in the world, actually. And with that, I will walk you through it. On one hand, you see the social challenges, so a part of Society 5.0. You have the red pillar, which is about productivity, the blue pillar about healthcare, and the green pillar about mobility. And then also we have the technological process. And just to move into the three phases that belong there. So these are the three phases. Right now, we are transmitting from phase one to phase two. And what you can see here is that phase one is all about, well, using it in the private sector and industrializing it. Phase two is using AI in our daily lives. So in some domains, as the examples already shown, we are already doing that. And then the third phase is to combine these different domains together in one big ecosystem so they can also aid each other. And that might be a big bit vague now, but I will just show you the end goals. So the first one, the productivity pillar. Well, this is about distributing of goods and services consistent with the needs of society. And where they want to be around 2030 is to create a zero waste society. That's at least a big goal of this pillar. And what they want to do is use AI for creating a stable supply chain, but also to use it to predict what the needs of society are and to give the consumers the ability to make tailor-made goods. And with that, over time, they want to create a zero waste society. And what I also saw here is that this might be an interesting pillar if you're working on the state secretary visit, because this one is very much about agro technology and smart services and smart industry. Then we have the second pillar. This one is healthcare. You can imagine this one also very much about the aging society of Japan. And well, one of the future goals here is to have nanorobots working inside the human body or artificial organs or telemedicine and preemptive medicine. And well, in 2030, they actually want to have it normalized that you have a nursing robot at your home, working as a family-like being. And this nursing robot is not just cooking and cleaning for you, but this nursing robot can also interact with you on a human level. So with natural language processing, it can, well, decrease loneliness also a bit. So that's quite cute. And then we have the third pillar. This is about mobility. Well, the mobility pillar, I think most will think about autonomous driving, and this is a big part of this pillar. But it's also very much about virtual travel. So like we're having here today, this hybrid version is definitely part of this pillar. And it's about creating a cyberspace, virtual office spaces, virtual tourism. And in the end, this pillar wants to decrease the needs to travel altogether. So one of the end goals is to create robots that are remote controlled, so employees do not have to go to their work to do physical labor. And to show you one example of that, I have this robot. And I think this robot, it looks quite futuristic, but this robot is actually already employed by Lawson last September. And of course, still a demo project, but it can stock the shelves and it can be remote controlled from home. And over time, enhanced with AI, it can also interact with consumers. So that it is on the policy. Moving on to the actors and sectors. Well, what I did here, it was actually the start of my project. And what I did here is look at three different types of actors. The first one, it was the government. Second one, industry, and specifically electronics, automotive, and the robotics industry, because these are just the most interesting for AI in Japan. And of course, I also looked at universities and research institutes. And then basically I checked how do they relate with each other? Are they sharing information? Are they coordinating? Where are the funds coming from? Where's the knowledge coming from and the technology? And well, don't read it all, but this is how they interact with each other. And this is basically how the AI ecosystem functions. And if you're really interested in a specific relationship, because I will not describe everything here, I would recommend to read my report because it's detailed described there. But now I will just zoom in on the government. And I looked at these actors in the government. Of course, these are not all the actors that are relevant, but these are the most relevant. And I think here the most interesting are the ministries. And why it is because they all have a different research center which they take care of. So you have the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science and Technology, MEXT, the Ministry of Economics, Trade and Industry, METI, and the Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communication. Now, why do they all support a different research institute? It's actually very simple because every research institute is creating their own AI. So we can see that METI is supporting the research institutes that is working on AI in the private sector. And also this research center is collaborating with a European Union universities, but not with the Netherlands, unfortunately. Then we also have MEXT. This is more about generic AI technologies. And this one is collaborating with European Union institutes as well, but again, not with the Netherlands specific. And then we have finally, the Ministry of Communication working very much on communication, like natural language processing and translation and speech processing. So with that is actually a quite clear explanation why these relations are the way they are. So now moving on to the industries more specific. This is the automotive industry. And I think this industry is quite interesting because they are actually the biggest R&D spenders in Japan. So the first spot is actually going to Toyota, then Honda, and then Nissan. And I think the fourth spot is already occupied by a company affiliated with Toyota. So there's a lot of money coming from the automotive industry. And most R&D funds that are about artificial intelligence, they are about autonomous driving. But this is also about navigation and product enhancement. So imagine that you can update your car instead of buying a new one. And this is how they interact with each other. They are quite internationally focused. And if we move on to the next industry, you can see that it's a little bit less. So this is the electronics industry. This is how they interact. And they are very much focused on the research part of the actors. And if we also look at the fact that they are collaborating with international universities, I think that's quite interesting. But among the international universities, I did not see any European ones. And this industry is mostly working on, internet services and fintech and network optimization and fraud detection. And with that, I think also this sector is the most interesting for the smart services part of the state secretary visit. Now, moving on to the robotics industry. Very interesting for the smart industry track. And this one is very domestically focused, but is working together quite a lot with other industries as well. And they very much focus on industrial robots, which is logical, but also factory automation. And they're also working together with the gaming industry. And this is just a quick overview of the AI ecosystem. Because now I will move on to COVID-19. So a lot of data I showed were from before COVID-19. But during my time here, I also saw a lot of changes because of COVID-19. And of course, COVID-19 has actually hit the economy quite a bit. And that's also impacting AI investments. And especially if I'm looking at the three pillars of Japan, so productivity, healthcare, and mobility, then productivity and mobility are hit a bit. So the first one, productivity. Productivity has a luxury part in it. And it is kind of expected that these luxury AI experiences and the tailor-made consumer things, that they might be delayed a bit because it is less likely that consumers are spending money on luxury things during an economic decline. And the second one is mobility. As the actor analysis showed, the automotive industry is spending quite a lot of money on R&D, but they have also been hit quite hard in this crisis. So short-term speaking, they will see some delay. And also the autonomous driving car, which is expected to be delayed for, the average consumer. However, I do not think that COVID has been just negative for AI. Even though investments in some places have somewhat decreased, I think COVID also creates an environment which could be quite beneficial for AI development. Because we need to use more digital alternatives for what was normally physical. And just to show this, COVID-19 has been an incentive for digitalization. And in my case, I worked here only 3 weeks before COVID happened. So I'm not sure what the normal situation was exactly, but I don't think we used to have digital alternatives, or at least not use them as much as we're doing now, right? So it has been normalized quite a bit more. It is also more accepted, and often digital alternatives are offered. And digitalization and AI, they go hand in hand. So on one hand, AI, it thrives on data. So the more data we give it, the better it can develop. And on the other hand, we of course have AI that can optimize digital alternatives. And well, with the optimization of technology, technology that was already there, I think AI has actually seen some boost. And just to speak from my own experiences, before I got here, I have never used Microsoft Teams. It might be hard to believe, but it's true. And I saw in my month here that almost every month Microsoft Teams got a new update, and quite a lot of them are enhanced with AI. So for example, at one point it managed to actually recognize speech and also make subtitles of it in English. It can recognize where you are, giving you a nice background. And well, by now I think it can also recognize background noises like vacuum cleaners, and it filters this out. So I think in that way it has we have seen a rapid improvement of techniques, and with that created an opportunity well, to let AI grow in a faster pace. And with that, another finding, I saw that the Japanese government is not planning to decrease its R&D funding for AI. It might allocate it in a different manner, so with bigger focus on healthcare, but it will not decrease. And AI can also help in the global fight against COVID-19. So on one hand, it can help in the search for a vaccine, though I think we might have already found one, but it can predict well, combinations a lot faster than a human could ever do. It can also detect anomalies and calculate infection probabilities. And just to show you one other example, it can counter false information spread on social media, because by now the AI is well enough developed to actually understand the meaning of an article and flag it, as long as you train it well. And I would just like to move on to some Japanese examples of this. So I saw a lot of examples of techniques that have been altered during COVID-19. And especially a lot of robotic solutions. Well, in the Netherlands, or at least Europe, I think there's more focus on applications. So quite interesting, but here I try to make a balance between robots and techniques. So the first one, this is a robot that drives around Narita Airport. You might encounter this on your Christmas holidays. It is still a prototype, but well, it can scan from afar if you have a fever. And if you have a fever, it drives to you. And then it starts a teleconference with the doctor for you. Quite convenient, huh? Of course, we also have Fujitsu's hand washing machine. And this one managed to recognize hand movements, so it can recognize how you move your hand. But also it learns the 6 steps of how to wash your hands from the Ministry of Health. And it can check if you're using soap. So this one is apparently already employed in some healthcare and food industries. Then, of course, we have the face recognition system. We have one standing here outside as well. And this is, again, an example of a technique that was already there, but has been rapidly improved in a few months because of COVID. So before, it could recognize your face and your mood and your age and whatever, but not with a mask or with sunglasses. Now it can also recognize you and your age and your gender and your mood, even while wearing a mask. And I'm not here to say if that's a good or a bad thing. I'm just saying that it's possible. And then, of course, we have Pepper. Pepper is SoftBank's robot, and this one actually made even the Dutch headlines. Because in Tokyo, there's a robot hotel, and it is a project where the idea was to send COVID-19 infected patients to this robot hotel to have as least employees as possible. And Pepper was then supposed to show you around, and he has also a vacuum cleaner friend that can clean your room for you. And then the idea is to only have one doctor and a few nurses, and this way it can decrease the infection probability. So with that, just a few of the many, many examples also in Japan. And I would like to move on to the final part of the presentations. So these are the challenges and opportunities I saw for the Netherlands, but also the strengths and weaknesses I found in Japan. And the thing is, especially on the strengths, I think I've elaborated on that quite a bit. So also looking at the time, I will just skip through the strengths, but if you have a specific question about any of them, don't hesitate to ask. So, well, as said, the AI policy is already pretty clear, and big public and private investments. So if we move on to the weaknesses, because I think there is a big problem, and that is human resources. So Japan has a big problem with human resources, and not just Japan, the whole world has this, especially also the Netherlands. And what is expected that there will be a shortage of 120,000 AI experts in Japan. Now, how do they want to deal with this? On one hand, they try to attract international talent, but as I said, it's an international problem, so it might not be a very sustainable solution. And on the other hand, they want to change the education system, which brings us to the second weakness. Right now, Japan and also the OECD found that the education system of Japan is not very supportive of the skill set needed for AI. So they want to change this, but this will take some time, of course, for a new generation to be raised. And also the ambition for Japan is to have 250,000 extra AI experts, but they do not have enough teachers to reach this goal. So I think this is a very big problem. I also put knowledge sharing there. This is because the universities in Japan, of course, they publish more on AI every year, but relatively speaking, they're doing worse than the countries around them. And then finally, software. Well, I found that Japan is very hardware focused. They're very good at robots and car building, but there's also a more cyberspace part of it, software development and an online part. And I think there are some steps to make. But this also brings opportunities, I think, for the Netherlands. So Japan has said that they are open for partnerships on AI. They're actually looking for partnerships. And I think the European Union and also therefore the Netherlands, we do share a similar value. So this could be, we could be good partners, I think. So of course, also employment. If you are an AI expert and you want to work in Japan, I think you have some opportunities. And then finally, I put product enhancement and deep learning. And both of these, well, it's not that Japan can't do this, of course, but to reach their goals in 2030, they want to be a lot better in it. And I think the Netherlands could help them with that. And then finally, moving on to the challenges. And here, well, the first three are also interesting, but I will just move on to feasibility. And I think because this is our biggest challenge. So the thing is, as the actor analysis also shows, there are not much relationships with the Netherlands yet. And I don't think that is because we could not be good partners, but I think that's because we're not very visible for Japan yet. And well, why is this? Well, on one hand, the European Union is just not a front runner on AI. It's, well, the United States and China. And even though the Netherlands is one of the, well, yeah, one of the nine digital front runners in Europe, I do think that we could work a little bit more to let ourselves be visible and show that we're an interesting partner. So with that, my concluding remarks would be that I think that we have similar values. I also think we have complementary expertise and we have some social issues that actually, well, we share, like an aging population. I think Japan has already some well, AI enhanced solutions like nursing robots. And on the other hand, I think the Netherlands is quite good in, for example, agro technology. We already have AI harvesting robots and AI harvesting calculations. And we might actually be able to help each other with that. And so with that, concluding that we have similar values, complementary expertise, and also complementary digital solutions for societal problems, I think it would be interesting with the State Secretary visit to maybe start exploring a possible relationship in this domain as well. And now knowing that this was a lot of information, I would just like to give you five key takeaways. And this is the first one. AI is key in the Japanese society 5.0. So I think you will witness some changes in the next 10 years. And as already said, the robots are arriving at our local supermarkets. What I also think is interesting is, well, the Asia Pacific region is expected to become number one on the global market. And again, I think it's interesting to be in Japan during that time. Of course, AI R&D heavily supported by the public and private sector. And again, the third in the world also, it's not decreasing by the Japanese government. And I think this creates a healthy AI research environment. Then the fourth, yes, the pandemic has caused short-term budget cuts, but also has sparked a lot of AI-driven solution. And last but not least, despite the pandemic, AI is still booming. And with that, I would like to conclude my presentation. If you have any questions, please unmute yourself online and offline. And I would thank you very much for your attention today. So thank you.